Thank you everyone for standing by and welcome to our webinar entitled Why We Don't Believe Science, a Perspective from Decision Psychology. These webinars are initiative of the Ohio State University Climate Change Outreach Team, a multi-departmental effort within the university led by Ohio Sea Grant, Office of Research, Ohio Supercomputer, OSU Extension, and several other OSU departments to help localize the climate change issue for Ohioans and Great Lakes residents. I am Jill Gentis-Benicki from Ohio Sea Grant and Stone Laboratory, and joining me today is Dr. Ellen Peters of the Ohio State University. Dr. Ellen Peters is Professor of Psychology and Director of the Decision Sciences Collaborative at Ohio State. Her research focuses on understanding the basic building blocks of human judgment and decision making, including how critical information can be communicated to facilitate better decisions in health, financial, and environmental contexts. She is a former president of the Society of Judgment and Decision Making, former chair of FDA's Risk Communication Advisory Committee, and is the current member of the National Academies Committee on the Science of Science Communication. We are delighted to have her here today to talk to us about decision psychology. But before we get started, a few logistical issues during our presentation. All participants will be in a listen-only mode. Afterwards, I will conduct a question and answer session. If you would like to ask a question during the presentation, feel free to ask using the chat feature located on the right-hand side of your screen, and I will collect and pose your questions out to Dr. Peters at the end of her presentation. We have nearly 500 participants so far on this webinar, a great diverse group representing governmental agencies, academia, and nonprofit groups from the Great Lakes and around the country. Please keep those questions coming throughout the presentation. We should have a great Q&A session. As a reminder, this webinar is being recorded and will be posted onto our website for later viewing. Also, we will post a webinar survey in the chat feature toward the end of the hour. Please take a few minutes after the webinar to fill out that survey. It will help us continue to bring you better webinars. So without any further delay, I would like to introduce Dr. Ellen Peters. Dr. Peters, I am going to unmute you, and I'm going to hand you the ball here.
That's perfect. Thank you, Jill.
Oh, actually, hold on, sorry. Let me have the ball back again for 1 second.
Okay.
So I can give you your PowerPoint presentation.
Oh, because I'm going to do it from my, right, good.
All right.
Okay, are we ready?
You are in good shape, thank you.
Perfect. Thank you so much for the introduction, Jill, and especially for inviting me to give this talk. And thanks to the many of you out there who are listening. I hope I'm able to teach you something and something that's interesting even. What we're going to talk about today is a perspective from decision psychology on why we don't tend to believe science. And I want to start off with a few facts about a few scientific facts. First of all, a recent report from the Pew Research Center found that about 79% of Americans think that science has made life easier for most people. According to the National Science Foundation Science Indicators from 2016, Americans are also more likely to have a great deal of confidence in leaders of the scientific community than in leaders of any other group except for the military. At the same time, though, we don't always believe in science. So, for example, 88% of scientists believe that genetically modified foods are generally safe to eat. Compared to the public, only 37% of them believe the same thing. Among scientists, 86% believe that vaccines should be required in childhood, compared to only 68% of the public. 94% of scientists believe that climate change is a very serious problem or somewhat serious problem, compared to only 65% of the public. So Americans seem to believe in science, but not to always believe in scientific findings. And what we're going to do today is we're going to, if I can get this to work, there we go. What we're going to do today is we're going to focus in particular on how we judge risks and make decisions. And we're going to start off with some of the themes that come from my field of decision psychology. And that'll lead us into some of the work that's been done about beliefs, and beliefs about risks in particular. We're going to examine some of the many ways in which human judgment can be biased. And when I say biased, I simply mean that judgments can be influenced by factors that ideally shouldn't be involved. And in the end, what we're going to look at is this idea that beliefs can be constructed, and we persist in those beliefs. That belief persistence can be rational in some cases, and perhaps not as rational if you look at it from a different lens. But that how we present information to people should end up mattering to beliefs and belief persistence. So let's go ahead and get started. And I have to remember how I switch these slides because it's not my usual way. So let's get started first with four general themes in the psychology of judgment and decision making. The first is something that you're probably all aware of. It's the idea that every day we're bombarded with a vast number of decisions and an overwhelming quantity of information. It's all this stuff that we have to deal with each and every day. So, for example, today there's probably a whole bunch of minor decisions you've already made. What to have for breakfast? Whether to attend this webinar? What clothes to wear? There's all kinds of decisions that we make every day. Some of them we think through, some of them are more habitual, but we are bombarded with an almost overwhelming quantity of decisions and information. They're also much more important or major decisions. You might have recently decided whether to get married, whether to change careers. Those are even more important decisions. But again, there's a vast number of them that we have to make. And the problem with that is that we have limited resources. Human beings are capable of these absolutely tremendous feats of intellect, but we're what's called boundedly rational. We can't possibly attend to and process all of the information and all of the options with which we're faced. And because of our bounded rationality and our inability to be able to take everything into account, we end up taking a lot of mental shortcuts. We use mental shortcuts when judging risks and when making decisions about them. As Herbert Simon once said, we satisfice. We make decisions and form judgments that are good enough. They may not be ideal, they may not be the absolute best, but they're pretty good. We satisfice. And this process can be incredibly adaptive. It's very efficient because otherwise that bombardment of information and options can overwhelm us. And it's also adaptive because what we end up with really, really is frequently good enough. It can end up with worse decisions, so it can be maladaptive in some ways. These mental shortcuts we often call heuristics, and we use heuristics to judge and to decide. Some examples of heuristics, just sort of everyday simple heuristics, are things like we might conclude that a person is closed or defensive because they have their arms crossed. Or we might decide to eat at restaurant D rather than A because B has more cars in its parking lot, so probably the food is better. We use that as a heuristic. A great risk perception one is people deciding not to swim in the ocean because you just saw the movie Jaws. The fourth theme from the psychology of judgment and decision making is the idea that we frequently don't know our own true value for an object or a situation. So we don't, for example, know exactly how much a house is worth or how much risk is really posed by climate change or some disease. And because we don't know our true values for objects and situations, we often end up constructing our values and our preferences and our beliefs based on cues in the situation, but also based on who we are as decision makers. And so later on in the talk, we're going to look at different liberal versus conservative leanings and how they help us to construct values and preferences and beliefs. But let's take a look first at some of the psychology. So beliefs and judgments should arise from an intentional process in which we gather all the relevant information, we discount irrelevant information, we weight relevant information objectively, and thereby we come to a decision. So ideally we're objective when we think and decide. That's really what we'd like to do. But that is not how the human mind works. Instead of that objective process, what ends up happening instead is that we actually are influenced by a huge number of systematic heuristics and biases. And we study many of these in my field. We're influenced by irrelevant cues in ways that affect judgments, risk perceptions and judgments and decisions outside of our awareness. We're also influenced by our own moods and emotions. What we're going to focus on more today, though, is the idea that we actually seek out, interpret, and weigh information according to our preconceived opinions, according to what we've thought ahead of time. Beliefs end up shaping how we judge and decide, and they themselves can be constructed. They persist. They're hard to give up if they're our own beliefs. Even harder, perhaps, is trying to change somebody else's beliefs. These beliefs can color our perceptions of reality. They can color our perceptions of exactly what's out there. And this isn't just true for lay people, it's also true for experts. And so I wanted to tell you briefly about one study. 57 wine experts were asked to taste two glasses of wine, one red wine and one white wine. But unbeknownst to these wine experts, the wines were actually the same white wine, one of which had been tinted red with food coloring. That red tinting, though, and the fact that they were actually the same white wine didn't stop the experts from describing the red wine in language that's typically used to describe red wine. One expert praised its jamminess, while another enjoyed its crushed red fruit. Not a single one noticed that it was actually a white wine. This is an example of what we would call belief persistence, the tendency to maintain beliefs without sufficient regard to the evidence against them or the lack of evidence in their favor. So the simple color of the wine, the redness of the wine, led people to believe it was going to be a red wine, and then they maintained that belief with sufficient regard to the evidence, that the taste of the wine itself. Some other examples of that, perhaps in our own lives, we tend to persist in beliefs like the safety of the 5-second rule with food. I hate to tell all of you, but it's actually not true. We tend to persist in beliefs about the idea that getting a base tan will protect you against sunburn. And this kind of belief persistence can be quite rational. It inspires us with the confidence to try more, to pursue lofty goals, to go on to graduate school, to initiate a new relationship. But it can also be irrational, and it can cause us to make worse decisions potentially. So, for example, you might continue to pursue someone romantically who really just isn't interested. Or a person with clinical anxiety might continue with a debilitating fear of death that has large negative consequences on the life that they would like to lead. But it is a gray area, whether belief persistence is rational or irrational. So Thomas Edison, who invented the light bulb, once said, "I have not failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that it won't work." Rational or irrational? It's not always clear. So why do we persist in our beliefs? We persist in our beliefs because of two general processes that lead to a particular bias. So we tend to selectively perceive information. We see and believe what we want to see. We also, though, selectively expose ourselves to information. We search for what we want to see. And these two processes of selective perception of information and selective exposure of information lead to what we call confirmation biases. But let's look at some of the research. And let's start off with selective perception. So again, this is the idea that we see what we want to see and we believe what we want to believe. And one of the first studies on selective perception was done by Lord Ross and Lepper. And what they did is they had subjects, half of whom favored capital punishment and half of whom opposed capital punishment. And they took all of those subjects, both groups, and everybody read the same two studies. One of which confirmed beliefs about capital punishment. There was pro-capital punishment, and one that disconfirmed beliefs. So everybody read the same thing. Subjects, however, selectively perceived the two reports. It turns out that the report that agreed with their own a priori attitude was more convincing, where the other reports had more flaws. So people actually, even though they all got the same information, they actually saw different information. They perceived the information differently, and they perceived it in ways that were consistent with their a priori beliefs. So you might recall that the average for these subjects, in terms of their average attitude before, half of them opposed capital punishment and half of them favored it. And logically, both sides should then become more neutral, or they should at least stay the same, because everybody read information that was balanced, half for capital punishment and half opposed to it. However, after reading the reports, attitudes actually polarized further. People seem to weight consistent information quite a lot and inconsistent information very little. And as a result, those attitudes polarized. They became more extreme than what they started out as. We not only selectively perceive what's in front of us, but we do also selectively expose ourselves to information that's consistent with our own beliefs. We search for what we want to see. So liberals will tend to watch, if they want to watch news, they watch CNN. Conservatives, on the other hand, will tend to watch Fox News or other conservative outlets. An interesting example of this from the 1970s had to do with Richard Nixon. It turned out that interest in Nixon's demise depended upon whether you voted for Nixon, you were not interested in finding out about his demise, or you voted for McGovern. And if you voted for McGovern, you were very interested in finding out what happened to Nixon. In another experimental example conducted by Lowen, subjects in this study could order free brochures about their own political candidate or the opposing political candidate. And what Lowen found was that brochure orders depended on how well the brochure helped to maintain their beliefs. So what they did is they did an experimental manipulation. So half of their subjects were randomized to a condition where they were given strong arguments, both for the individual's own candidate and for the other candidate. The other half of the participants were given brochures that had weak arguments, both for their own candidate, and then the other brochure had weak arguments for the other candidate. And people were simply asked, would you like to order brochures for your own candidate, or would you like to order brochures for the other candidate? And what they found was that if there were strong arguments for both candidates, people were much more likely to order their own brochures for their own candidate, and much less likely to order brochures for the other candidate. Because the strong arguments, if you ordered it for your own candidate, helped to maintain your belief, your a priori belief. But if you got strong arguments for the other candidate, it wouldn't. It would actually undermine your a priori belief. On the other hand, when the participants got weak arguments, the brochures that had weak arguments about your own candidate and the other candidate, well, you don't want to hear weak arguments about your own candidate. And what happened is that people tended to be much more likely to order the brochures about the other candidate because those weak arguments could further undermine beliefs of the other, interest in the other candidate, and thus help you to maintain your own beliefs. Beliefs are surprisingly stable because we're often closed to challenges to those beliefs. Selective perception and selective exposure to information tend to lead us to confirm our hypotheses and beliefs rather than testing against information that might disconfirm them. We tend to not want to do that. And there's a question about whether this is rational, whether it's good for us. And in some ways, it is rational. It's rational in the sense that it's efficient. It takes us far less effort. And it's often good enough in most circumstances. But it's not rational in the sense that it allows us to maintain beliefs that simply aren't true. It may also leave us worse off as a society. And what I'd like to do now is look at a couple of examples of risk perceptions in environmental domains. This is work that I've done with Dan Kahan and others. And what we look at in these two examples is the idea that experts believe that the public often doesn't perceive enough risk in at least some domains, for example, like climate change, and we're going to use climate change as an example. Experts also believe that the public perceives too much risk other times. An example there is nuclear power. And what we looked at in this the PIT, experts essentially think that the public is irrational, and for a few reasons. First, they think that the public tends to be scientifically illiterate and innumerate. Not everybody, but a fairly large proportion of the population. They also believe that the public is boundedly rational, and the public is boundedly rational, and uses heuristics in place of knowing the science and knowing the numbers. The experts also believe that the public uses other non-numeric sources of information, like their fear of new technology or their political leanings, and we're going to focus on political leanings today. And so we decided to test this public irrationality thesis in the domain of climate change as well as nuclear power. And what we did was a study of the U.S. population. We have a sample of about 1,500 subjects. Knowledge Networks is the company that collected the data for us. And what we asked people was, how much risk do you believe climate change poses to human health, safety, or prosperity? And what I'm showing you in the graph that you have in front of you is risk perception on the y-axis. So greater risk perceptions are higher, lower risk perceptions are lower. And I'll explain what the x-axis is. I'll explain what the x-axis is in a moment. The x-axis itself is numeracy and scientific literacy. So people who are less numerate and scientifically literate are on the left, and on the right are people who are more numerate and more scientifically literate. And the prediction from the public irrationality thesis is the idea that innumeracy and scientific illiteracy lead to bounded rationality and climate change perception. And what that should end up meaning is that people who know less about numbers and about science, they're simply going to perceive less risk about climate change compared to individuals who are higher in numeracy and scientific literacy, who are going to understand the facts, and they're going to realize, like the experts do, that it poses more risk. And so this is the pit prediction. Again, so people who are higher in numeracy and scientific literacy should perceive more risk compared to those individuals who are lower in numeracy and scientific literacy. But let's look at what actually happened. This is the actual variance. What actually happens in this data is that people who know more about numbers and about science, they actually perceive a little less risk from climate change than those individuals who are lower in numeracy and lower in scientific literacy. And that's inconsistent, as you can see, with the pit prediction. The negative correlation, and that's the negative correlation between numeracy and scientific literacy with those risk perceptions of climate change, it's a very small negative correlation, but it's nonetheless the opposite of the pit prediction. So the other thing, of course, you might recall that experts think the public does is they rely on cultural cognitions or worldviews. And this is very consistent with the literature. We know that these worldviews guide the evaluation of information about societal risks in ways where individuals who are more hierarchical compared to egalitarian, they tend to believe that societal classifications like age and gender and family lineage, that those should be the basis for status and resources and opportunities. Those individuals who are more individualistic tend to believe that people should fend for themselves, while those who are more communitarian believe that people should interact and cooperate. And these ideological worldviews are associated with risk perceptions in environmental domains, perhaps because those who are higher in hierarchy and individualism don't believe in heavy regulation of industry. So that what ends up happening is that individuals who are more hierarchical and individualistic, they tend to be skeptical of environmental risks. For those who are more egalitarian, more communitarian, they tend to be more concerned about environmental risks. And we can look at our data for that. What I'm showing you here is the same graph again. I've got risk perception on my y-axis. I have, and then we're going to leave the x-axis alone for now. Because first I want to show you just how numeracy makes a difference to risk perceptions, just the way I showed you before. But then look to see what happens with cultural cognitions or worldviews. There's a much greater relationship there. Those individuals who are more egalitarian and communitarian, they perceive far greater risk from climate change than individuals who are hierarchical and individualistic. And the relationship is much stronger than that for numeracy and scientific literacy. And so there is another prediction, though. So the pit prediction first was that cultural cognitions would matter to risk perceptions, and that is the case. Cultural cognitions seem to be used perhaps as a heuristic substitute, but there's a pit prediction that goes further than that, and that's that those cultural cognitions should be used more by people who are lower in numeracy and lower in scientific literacy. Because those individuals who are higher, they might not come together on the right facts, but they should come together on the facts. You know, maybe they've been presented wrong so that people higher in numeracy and scientific literacy didn't quite get to where the experts thought they should, but they should at least come together on the facts, and they should be influenced less by a heuristic substitute like cultural cognition. So this is the pit predicted, that predicted interaction from the public irrationality thesis with numeracy and scientific literacy. The black line that you can see is the data I showed you before. People who are more numerate tend to perceive a little less risk than those who are less numerate. But at least according to the pit, to the public irrationality thesis, if people are going to be using these cultural cognitions, they should be used more by people who understand less. So people who are lower in numeracy and scientific literacy should show a greater divide between egalitarian and communitarian, so you can see, perceive a lot of risk, and individuals who are hierarchical and individualistic who perceive a lot less risk. But among, as you go to the right, among those individuals who are higher in numeracy and scientific literacy, you should see these cultural cognitions being used less. They should be used as less of a heuristic substitute. As these individuals, whatever it is that they understand, they come together on those facts. So that's the pit prediction. Let's take a look at what actually happens. So again, I have risk perception on my y-axis. My numeracy and scientific literacy scores are on my x-axis. This is what happens with the egalitarians and communitarians. And look what happens. We actually get a greater political divide among people who are highly numerate and highly scientifically literate. So this is the actual interaction of cultural cognitions and numeracy and scientific literacy. Among those individuals who are low in numeracy and scientific literacy, cultural cognitions do play a big role. But among those individuals who are high in numeracy and scientific literacy, there's an even bigger divide. Polarization increases as numeracy and scientific literacy increase. You see similar polarization effects for both climate change. I'm showing you the same data that I showed you a second ago on the right-hand side for climate change. On the left-hand side for climate change. But you also see a similar polarization effect for nuclear power on the right-hand side, where greater polarization exists among those individuals who know more about numbers and who know more about science. So why might this happen? Why might polarization increase with more knowledge about numbers and science? It doesn't make sense in a lot of ways. And it particularly doesn't make sense when we think about the goal that people should have in these situations is to learn the facts and allow them to influence our beliefs. But instead, what we're seeing is something else. And instead, what we seem to be seeing is that people want to remain part of their group. If I'm a hierarch, I want to belong, and I might not belong as much if I disagree with things that people who are hierarchical believe. If I'm an egalitarian, I want to remain part of my egalitarian group and with my egalitarian friends. And if I disagree, I may end up not belonging as much. And we have these very, very strong goals to belong. And as a result, one way to think about belief persistence is that it may be quite rational for the individual who has to live with their family, who has to live with their friends, who are part of these groups and with a strong goal to belong to those groups. And those individuals who have more skills, whether with numbers or with science, they may actually be better at it. They may be better at recognizing and working towards this strong goal for group belonging and an individual kind of rationality, even though society is worse off because we can't agree on the facts. But at least it should be the case that we can agree on the answer to a math problem, because 2 + 2 is always 4, right? Unless subjective perception matters when it comes to objective facts. And so we were curious about that, so we did an experiment. What we did in this experiment, there are actually two different parts to the experiment. I'm only going to talk about the first part right now. I'm going to talk about the skin cream experiment, which is only half of the experiment. And in this experiment, we essentially have people do math. What we do is we tell them that medical researchers have developed a new cream for treating skin rashes. And these new treatments often work, but sometimes they make rashes worse. And even when treatments don't work, skin rashes sometimes get better and they sometimes get worse on their own, just like every other medicine. And as a result, it's necessary to test any new treatment in an experiment to see whether it makes the skin condition of those who use it better or worse than if they had not used it at all. So researchers have conducted an experiment on patients with skin rashes. In the experiment, one group of patients used the new skin cream for 2 weeks. That's the row on the top in the table below, where another group of patients did not use the new skin cream. That's the row on the bottom. And then what you can see in the table below is that among those patients, for some of them the rash got better, and for others the rash got worse. And in the end, what we end up asking people is just what result does the study support? Is it the case that people who used the skin cream were more likely to get better than those who didn't, or were more likely to get worse than those who didn't? And let me blow that up just a little bit so you can see it a little bit better. So again, this is the table that I showed you with the question just beneath it. And let me show you the right answer first, in case you haven't worked through it yet. So the proportion of people who got better among those patients who did use the new skin cream was 74.8%. Among those patients who didn't use the new skin cream, though, more of them got better. So the correct answer in this case is that people who used the skin cream were more likely to get worse than those who didn't. In this particular experiment, we actually varied whether the skin cream made the rash increase or decrease. What I'm showing you right now is the table that I showed you a moment ago. But notice that I'm going to click again, and the column labels are going to change. So in the first part, in the first half of the skin cream experiment, the column on the left is labeled the rash got better. In the other half of the participants, the rash got worse. So the correct answer depends upon which of those two tables you got. The numbers, however, remain the same. We just changed what the column labels were. And what you find is that people who are more numerate are better able to solve this problem. So what I'm showing you on the y-axis are the proportion of people who actually correctly interpret the data. They get the right answer. On the x-axis are numeracy scores. We measured people's numeracy with 9 items, so they can get anywhere from 0 correct up to 9 correct. And what you can see is that regardless of whether the right answer is that the skin cream decreases rashes or increases rashes, people who are more numerate are simply better at locating that answer, at figuring out what that answer is. And that makes sense. That should be the way it is. Scores on a math test should produce more correct, should be associated with more correct answers. However, we have another half of the experiment also. So for half the experiment, we used a skin cream problem. In the other half, we used a more politically divisive topic. And we had people do math in a gun ban experiment. So in this case, a city government is trying to decide whether to pass a law banning private citizens from carrying concealed handguns in public. The government officials are unsure whether the law will be more likely to decrease crime by reducing the number of people carrying weapons, or whether it will increase crime by making it harder for law-abiding citizens to defend themselves from violent criminals. Researchers completed a study of two groups of cities to answer that question. In one group of the cities did ban carrying concealed handguns in public. That's the first row in the table below. The other group of cities did not ban carrying concealed handguns in public. That's the second row of the table below. And then what you can see in that table below is that in some of the cities, crime decreased, and in some of the cities, crime increased. And once again, we're simply asking people, what's the correct answer to this problem? Is it the case that cities that enacted a ban on carrying concealed handguns were more likely to have a decrease in crime or an increase in crime? It is the same math problem. I don't know if you noticed, but the tables were identical between this and the skin cream problem. The actual math was the same. And the question is, what ends up happening? Is it the case that in this more politically divisive domain, the people who are higher in numeracy will still be more likely to get the problem correct? Once again, like before, we actually, for half the people in the gun ban part of this experiment, the correct answer is that crime decreases. For the other half, crime increases. Let's look to see what happens. So this is the skin cream problem again. And what you can see, once again, is that with greater numeracy on the x-axis, people are more likely to get the skin cream problem correct. But what about gun control? Here what you can see is that it's not quite as obvious. It's not quite as obvious that the people who are highly numerate are going to be more likely to get this correct. There's something a little strange going on in the data. And what we thought was that maybe understanding of the facts may be driven in part by political beliefs and what you want to believe is happening. And so here, once again, what we did is we divided people out by their political leanings. The Liberal Democrats are in blue, and Conservative Republicans are in red. And then you can see all the different conditions, the two conditions, whether the rash increases or the rash decreases. And it turns out that political leanings don't matter for the skin cream problem. And that's kind of what you would expect. It's not a politically divisive problem. But what about political leanings when it comes to gun control? Here what you can see is that it makes a difference. And let me unpack this for you little by little. But it turns out that political leanings matter for correct interpretation of the data here. Let's start with the Conservative Republicans in red. They want to believe that gun control will increase crime. And in fact, when someone's a conservative Republican, and the correct answer is that crime increases, conservative Republicans who are more numerate are more likely to get the answer correct compared to conservative Republicans who are less numerate. But what about when the correct answer doesn't agree with what they want? What about when crime decreases? That's the solid red line down at the bottom. And all of a sudden, it's not as clear The people who are highly numerate are more likely to get the problem correct. They look an awful lot like people who are less numerate, although you do see a small effect. And this effect is not limited to conservative Republicans. Liberal Democrats would like to believe that increased gun control laws will decrease crime, and in fact, those who are more numerate are more likely to get that problem correct. But when it comes to a belief that they don't hold, when the correct answer is that gun control will actually increase crime, it's almost as if people's math abilities are turned off. It's very interesting. There are partisan differences in what's the right answer, and it's a math problem. The highly numerate were more likely to get the right answer overall, but there is this huge political polarization of what was considered a fact, and that political polarization was stronger among the people who are highly numerate and not as strong among the individuals who are less numerate. Getting it right seems to depend on the correct answer, but it also depends on whether the correct answer agrees with what you want to see, and especially if you're more numerate. And so there are a variety of reasons why we might not believe in some scientific facts. Some of it does have to do with numeracy and science literacy. The public, the American public is not as numerate and as scientifically literate as perhaps we should all be. At the same time, we do tend to be boundedly rational and we do use heuristics. But on top of that, we show these confirmation biases that seem to be driven by selective exposure of information and selective perception of information. This is Leon Festinger, a famous psychologist, and he once said, "A man with a conviction is a hard man to change. Tell him you disagree and he turns away. Show him facts or figures and he questions your sources. Appeal to logic and he fails to see your point." That doesn't mean it's hopeless, though. It turns out that how you present information matters. Now, this is sort of a tongue-in-cheek example. The little boy was told by his mom to give his sister a cookie, and he asks her, "Do you want the one I licked or the one I sat on?" And he concludes by saying, with both cookies in hand, "It's all in how you present things." But there are these evidence-based strategies for communicating information that work. It's important to provide numeric information as opposed to not providing it. It's important to, another evidence-based strategy, and there are a whole bunch of different techniques for doing this, but it's important to reduce the cognitive effort that someone requires to be able to understand the information. And there are a whole bunch of different techniques for doing this. Number two is particularly important for people who are less numerate. We need to be able to provide a value of meaning, particularly when information is unfamiliar, because sometimes someone can know that it is a 9% risk, but they may not know the good or bad meaning of that 9% risk for the judgment that they're trying to form or the decision that they're trying to make. And when that information is unfamiliar, by providing a value of meaning, you can help them use that information more. And then the fourth sort of theme the fourth type of strategy that comes with evidence that, for which we have a good evidence base, is that we can draw attention to important information. And again, there are a variety of strategies that can be used there. And so in the end, careful choices of how information is presented in conjunction with knowing what the goals of your communication are will increase comprehension and will increase use of important information. Of course, sometimes motivated information processing is just going to occur. When it comes to climate change beliefs, the evidence says that about 97% of climate scientists have concluded that human-caused climate change is happening. But according to Nicholas Kristof in the New York Times, only 44% of Americans believe humans are causing climate change, versus 77% who believe that aliens have visited Earth. And so what can we do when beliefs are motivated? Some of the best ways to change or give up beliefs are first to ask others to critique their own judgment. You should do it too. Try to assume the logical opposite of your belief and see how well the data fit the opposite of your belief. That's one of the best ways to change beliefs. To give up a belief merely saying that it's false doesn't help. Instead, replace it with a plausible belief, alternative belief or hypothesis. So in conclusion, preferences and beliefs in scientific data should be independent. They're not independent. People don't always believe science, and for a variety of reasons, some of which are motivated. But communication is not an easy task. Communicators often overestimate what others know. They overestimate how well they themselves communicate. Because of that, they lose opportunities to improve their communication. But also, the public is not adept at using the complex and often numeric information that's important to good climate decisions and other kinds of decisions. Evidence-based communication techniques do exist. They should be used strategically. Communicators should decide what the goals of the communication are and then carefully choose how to present information in order to maximize attaining that goal. But we also need more research into how to communicate best in areas where beliefs are motivated. Thank you very much. I appreciate your attention and your time. If you're interested in OSU's Decision Sciences Collaborative, I've included my email there as well as the website. So thank you very much.
Hi, sorry everyone, we had a little bit of an audio problem there. One of the questions that we had was for Dr. Peters is, if you notice that these tendencies to believe what you want to believe, see what you want to see in yourself, how do you counter that?
Well, that's kind of what we were looking at before. And Jill, am I still able to control the slides for people? Can they see me changing the slides?
Yeah.
So there's a couple of things that you can do. Part of the problem ends up being that we're standing there in our own shoes, and we don't try to walk in someone else's shoes. We see things from our own perspective, and if you can kind of pick yourself up and put yourself in someone else's shoes, that's one way of changing your beliefs. It's one way of seeing someone else's data and looking to see whether it is consistent. Seeing someone else's beliefs and looking to see whether it's consistent with what the data are. And so critiquing your own judgment, assuming the logical opposite, is one of the things that can help quite a bit.
Thank you, Dr. Peters. Another question that we got was, I've read studies by organizations that suggest that the average American has a 4 to 6 grade level in terms of science knowledge. So should we be thinking like elementary school counselors to get the answer to be at least considered?
So I think that there's a couple of ways to think about it. There are short-term ways and there are long-term ways. So long-term is better education of science and working at teaching science, perhaps at those lower, starting of course with those lower levels, but continuing on into middle school and high school. Shorter term though, there are ways to communicate science in ways that are more sort of psychologically appropriate. So a lot of the work that I do is with number processing. How do you communicate numbers, which are often part of science communication? How do you communicate numbers so that people are better able to understand them and to use them? And sometimes that understanding of numbers and use of numbers is different. But one of the things you can do short term is the communicator, and this is part of what I was talking about towards the end too, communicators need to identify what the goal of their communication is. So sometimes the goal of communication is to help people understand all of the information. And that can be more or less realistic depending upon what it is, depending upon how much information there is, how much time that people have to understand the information. But even if that is your goal, even if you can't pick a subset of the information to try to teach them, there are ways that you can present that information, and that is part of science. There are ways that you can present that information so that people are better able to understand and use it. It's just that you need to decide what the goal is first and then choose an evidence-based technique for communicating information that's going to best accomplish the goal.
Thank you, Dr. Peters. Another question that we had was, could you talk a little bit about, we had quite a few people asking about the slide 20 and the citing the source of slide 20. And I'm sorry, I was going to go back to see what slide 20 was. We had quite a few people asking about in like the polarization slides, which I think is part of the slide 20, how did they assess people's numeracy / scientific literacy?
That's a great question. So there are a variety of ways that you can assess either one. The science literacy test that we use comes from the National Science Foundation. It's their scientific literacy scale. It includes things like a true-false question. I guess it's a multiple choice. Does the Earth go around, does the Earth go around the Sun or does the Sun go around the Earth? It might be the Moon instead of the Sun, I forget. But they're sort of basic science literacy questions, maybe about 8 of them or so. For the numeracy scale, again, there are a variety of ways to assess it. The numeracy items that we used are things like, they come originally from a paper by Schwartz and Woloshin, and then from Isaac Lipkis and some of his colleagues. They include things, items like, which of the following represents the biggest risk of getting a disease? 1 in 1,000, 1 in 10, or 1 in 100? And they simply have to pick out the right response. And we happen to use a scale, I think in this case, that had 9 items.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Peters. Another question that we had was, why was political affiliation measured instead of the measures of opinions about gun control specifically?
Oh, so why did we use kind of a more general political leanings rather than specifically how do you, what is your attitude towards gun control?
Yes.
It could have been done either way. I suspect the results would have been even stronger perhaps if we used those specific a priori attitudes about gun control. The reason we chose to do it the other way simply has to do with the idea that we carry around with us these predispositions that may end up influencing across a wide variety of different topics, how we perceive information and how we use that information. And we were more interested in that general tendency rather than the more specific beliefs. The more specific beliefs probably would have shown stronger results, but we didn't actually measure that. But it's also a very interesting question to look at. It's more consistent, that way of doing it would be more consistent with the study by Lord Leffer and Ross that I showed earlier in the talk.
Thank you, Dr. Peters. Another question that we had was systematic desensitization is used to gradually decrease people's fears of things and get more comfortable with them. Is there something from that approach that would be that could be used to gradually bring a group around to a different opinion?
So those kinds of desensitization techniques are used for things like acute anxiety, like a fear of spiders, a fear of heights. In those kind of cases, the person doesn't want to be afraid of spiders. The person doesn't want to fear heights. It's having the fears that they have, they recognize as irrational, and they want to do something about them. In these cases, these are not irrational beliefs. Some people believe in gun control. Other people believe that gun control is going to increase crime, and some people believe that gun control is going to decrease crime. And they have preferences in that way for it to be one way or another. Those are not irrational beliefs. And so, you know, I would argue that desensitization is simply not the right process here, is not the right technique to use here. What we want to be doing is we want people to be allowed their own values and to bring their values to bear on decisions that ultimately impact them and impact society. But we want them to come together more on the facts themselves. And the question is, how do you get people to come together on the facts while still maintaining their own values and preferences? So in my opinion, systematic desensitization simply isn't the right approach in this case.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Peters. Another question that we had was, you had mentioned four evidence-based strategies. Can you give a few more examples of how to do this using all four? Seems to be a challenge for short-term interaction.
Yeah, so I didn't go into those too much, only for lack of time. Let me see if I can find those. Do you have the slide number on that?
I don't.
I'll just slide and find them real quick. I'm going to take a sec. There it is. So the first one's pretty obvious. Provide the numbers as opposed to not providing it. And essentially providing the numbers helps people to be more informed. If you're in a context of like prescription drugs and you provide the likelihoods, you provide the numeric likelihoods of side effects versus you don't provide them. So for example, here in the United States, we often do not provide the numeric likelihoods of side effects. We give people kind of a laundry list. We sometimes tell them if one of them is particularly unlikely, but mostly we just give them a list. If you actually do provide the numeric likelihoods, that there's a 10% chance of this, that there's a 0.1% chance of that, that actually informs people. It reduces overestimates of risk. If you don't give them the numbers, people tend to overestimate the likelihoods of these side effects quite a bit. And it also makes, by reducing overestimates of risk, it also people also end up being more willing to take the drug. So that's the first one. It's fairly simple. In terms of reducing cognitive effort, there's a variety of things you can do. The simplest things would be if you have a lot of options. Let's say you have 12 options that you want someone to be considering. If you can reduce the number of options, it will increase comprehension of the information that remains and increase use of that important information. So if you can reduce the number of options, that's one way of doing it. Reducing the number of pieces of information for each option can also help quite a bit. Let's see, other ways of reducing cognitive effort. Sometimes in medicine, and I often work in health kinds of contexts, someone who's like a genetic counselor, for example, will inform somebody that they have a 1 in 200 risk of something happening. And then later on, well, if this happens, if your genetic test comes out in this way, then you have a 1 in 400 risk of that thing happening. The problem in that case is that they changed the denominator from 1 in 200 to 1 in 400, and people are actually really unclear about what that means. Is it bigger risk or smaller risk? And so one way of reducing cognitive effort, because they have to go to the effort of figuring out which one is bigger and which one is smaller, is you can simply keep the denominator constant. So you can say 2 in 400 versus 1 in 400, I forget which direction I did it. But that's another way of reducing cognitive effort, keep denominators constant. In terms of providing evaluative meaning, there's a variety of ways this can be done. You can think about this in a consumer reports kind of sense. Consumer Reports often uses a series of symbols that indicate whether something is above average, average, or below average for the group of things under consideration. And that provides just a little bit of evaluative meaning to information so that people don't have to dredge themselves through the numbers figuring out which one is bigger and which one is smaller and how does it compare to the others. Another way of doing it that we tested a little bit is we actually provide evaluative labels. So we were doing a study on quality of care indicators when it came to choosing a hospital. And what we found is that if we use evaluative labels for what is really unfamiliar information for people, we told people whether the quality of care number shown was poor or fair or good or excellent. People were just as able to remember the numbers, but they were better able to use them in the presence of the evaluative label. And again, that's particularly important when information is unfamiliar. We might recognize what a number is, but we don't know what it means all the time. And you need to understand and feel that good or bad meaning before you're able to use the information. Otherwise, it's just the number 9. It's just a symbol. And then the fourth strategy is to draw attention to important information. That can be done with larger fonts, colored fonts, movement on a screen. What other kinds of ways can we use? There's a variety of different ways that can be used there too. The idea is to draw attention to important information. You can even do it simply by ordering information from most important to least. They're going to pay attention to that first information. You could even put the most important information first as well as last to remind them that it's important. You want to make sure you consider it. That's another way of doing it. And just in general, if you choose carefully how that information is presented, it actually will increase comprehension and use of the information.
Thank you, Dr. Peters. Another question that we had was, and I'm sorry, I'm trying to make sure that I'm not repeating anything. We had a couple people asking about whether or not these studies included questions about the desire to belong to a group, or whether there were complementary studies that assessed people's motivation to accept or not to accept climate change based on their desires to fit in.
So I don't know of any specific studies that have measured that directly. We are interpreting our data in that way. There's lots of evidence that suggests that people have a very strong desire to belong, and we're really making assumptions about that as the explanation for our data. The data that I showed you are actually the data that we have, and it's the idea that our risk perceptions tend to be consistent with our cultural cognitions, and even more so if you're higher in ability. And we made the interpretation that probably means that's probably linked to our need to belong. But I don't know of any specific studies. No.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Peters. One other question that we had gotten was, did you consider running a within subject design to see if individuals who do the math correctly with skin cream also do correctly with gun control and vice versa? This person was wondering if people in the political treatment just didn't do the math.
Yes, so, let me try to rephrase it. So the question is, if you had people do the skin cream problem and the gun control problem, would the same people get it correct?
I think so.
So the short answer to that is that certainly not all of the same people would get it correct, because we're getting a lower proportion of people getting it correct in the gun control experiment than in the skin cream, and if it disagrees with what they believe a priori. We actually did run a version of this within subject. I don't have the data with me here today, but what we did is we randomly assigned people to either do the skin cream problem first or the gun control problem first, and then the other problem came after. And what we actually expected to see was that if they got the skin cream problem first, and then, you know, like 2 seconds later, they got the gun control problem, that having drawn them down that path of correctly solving the problem, particularly for the highly numerate people, that they would then be able to correctly solve the gun control problem. We totally expected that, and we didn't find it. So in that condition where they did skin cream first and then gun control, people in the skin cream problem, if they're highly numerate, they're much more likely to solve it correctly than people who are less numerate, just in the way that you might expect, in the way that I showed you earlier in this talk. But when they got to the gun control problem, it didn't really help the situation, and we were quite surprised. We're not entirely sure why, but those individuals where the correct answers didn't agree with what they wanted a priori, they were really no more likely to get it correct if they had done the skin cream problem correctly just before than if they hadn't. It was very inconsistent with what we expected to happen. We thought that pointing them in the right direction, they would continue to go in the right direction.
Okay, thank you. One last question, because we actually are at 1 o'clock. We had several people asking where, if there was a place that they could find that report.
And do you know which one?
I'm not totally sure which one it was. I think it was the one dealing with the scientific literacy and assessing people's scientific literacy.
So on the slides, the paper that had to do with risk perceptions of climate change and of nuclear power, that's in a paper by Kahan Peters et al. In, I believe, 2014. It's in the journal Nature Climate Change. If one of you guys would like to email me, I'm happy to point you in the right direction, though, and that might be the best way to deal with that. Let me see if I can put my email address up again.
I did get a clarification.
Okay.
They were wondering about slide 45. That was the report.
I'm sorry, that was the which?
That was the report, slide 45.
Okay, let me take a look at what that is. Oh, yeah, so this is a paper that was commissioned from us by the Institute of Medicine. It actually is available on the Institute of Medicine website. It's a free report. It's trying to think of how they would get it easily. It could be, so my suggestion again would be probably to email me, and I'm happy to email you a copy of it. Hang on a sec, let me get the name of the book though. So the full report that was put out by the Institute of Medicine is called Health Literacy and Numeracy Workshop Summary, and it's a summary of an entire workshop that was put together. The paper that we did was that was commissioned for it is Appendix A, and then the rest of the book we're discussing in part the paper that we did, and then in part other presentations that other researchers did. It's actually quite a good workshop summary, but specifically that the report that you're talking about is Appendix A of that book. I'm also happy to send it out to people if you email me.
Great, thank you so much.
I wish I could only interact with people a little bit more. It's a little hard doing it from such an abstract distance.
It is, but we really appreciate you being willing to talk with us today. I think we are out of time. We have a lot of questions, but we are out of time, unfortunately. So I'm going to wrap up a little bit here. I wanted again thank Dr. Ellen Peters for her willingness to talk to us about decision psychology. It was really an excellent discussion. We had some fantastic questions. I did also want to remind everyone that our survey URL for this webinar is in the chat feature, so please take a few minutes to fill that out. I also wanted to refer all of you to the resources and an archive of all the previous webinar presentations that are located on our changingclimate.osu.edu website, as well as our regional site at greatlakesclimate.com. This webinar series is sponsored by the OSU Climate Change Outreach Team, and we will be hosting webinars in the coming months. We'll email you when registration is available. Again, I wanted to thank Dr. Peters and all the participants on this webinar. We hope this was beneficial and hope you'll join us again in an upcoming webinar. Thank you again, Dr. Peters. Thank you, everyone, and have a great afternoon.